I grew up in Washington, D.C., and I had a very strong musical background. My mother played. She was a classical pianist. She had studied at Eastman. And then her mother played. She played in church. And her mother played, so it's generational. My mother would play Chopin and Beethoven and Rachmaninoff, and she would also really want to elevate African-American composers. So she would play George Walker and Margaret Bonds. And she was also a fantastic composer herself. I started playing piano when I was 3, and I remember seeing this giant piano, and I thought it was like a big toy. When I was around 8 years old, I started writing. I would start to improvise, but I always looked at the piano as a place where I could express myself. I grew up in a very diverse community. We had Greeks, Portuguese, Black people, Jewish people, people from Ghana, South Africa. So the music that I would hear in their households was also a big part of my influence. Then my brother would come home and he would bring Brazilian music and jazz with Lee Morgan and Coltrane. And then DC has its own kind of cultural vibe, the go-go and the hip-hop. And then I'd go to school and I'd hear Santana and all kinds of range of music. I didn't really understand at that time how informed that would make me as a composer, because I look at music as sonic storytelling. At the time when I was at Tufts, they had a consortium with New England Conservatory, so I was able to take classes at both schools. I studied with Jackie Byard for a little bit, the great jazz pianist. I studied with a variety of classical pianists as well, because I wanted to still maintain that for foundation. After college, I moved to New York, and I ended up meeting incredible players. We would perform and play at each other's shows and just support each other. To have the support of your community is crucial. It's a foundation that inspires you and motivates you to keep going. I had a really good friend of mine in New York, Edison Sainsbury. Later on, I said, Edison, why did you let me come over at 11:30 to write some music when you'd had a long day already? He said, because I believe in you and I love your music. Being able to be with people that see you for who you are, that's very important. I would also perform throughout New York City. I would find little venues and get my band going, and we would do a couple of sets here and there. And I started doing these jazz festivals, Copenhagen, Pori, Finland, Ronnie Scott's in London, and I started realizing the audiences there really liked the American jazz singer. I wanted to create music, period. So I would talk to people who were creators, playwrights, choreographers, and if they were working on a production, whether it would be at the public theater or any theater, I would begin that Q&A. So what are you doing for your music? So I began to write regional theaters, and somehow I began to get a reputation as someone who knew how to write for theater. I worked with Mary McClinton, who had been one of August Wilson's main directors for many years, and he asked me to write the music for a production he was doing at Syracuse Stage, Death and the King's Horsemen. It was phenomenal. I moved to LA from New York because I just needed a break from New York, and so I moved to Los Angeles. Very open to possibilities. August Wilson, when he was about to work on Gem of the Ocean, and August, part of his process was sort of workshopping in various regional theaters before going to Broadway. And so when they came to Los Angeles, Marion asked me to be the composer here at the Mark Taper and then on Broadway. Working with August Wilson was incredible. He was someone who was unwavering in his commitment to his voice as a writer, as a storyteller, as a griot. That dedication taught me the importance of respecting one's individual voice. I ran into Marion McClinton again, and he told me he was going to be a mentor at the Sundance Fellowship for Theater. Then when I went on their website and saw that they had this film composing fellowship, I have some things from my portfolio. I sent them in and I got that fellowship, and that changed everything. The first opportunity I got was on a film called Fronters, and it was, you know, incredible. Working with Ava DuVernay, Justin Simeon, Chinonye Chukwu, Timothy Greenfield Saunders, Sam Pollard, Yoruba Richin, James Redford. I mean, these are creatives in a league of their own.
Walk to the edge and dance with me. Walk to the edge and set yourself free.
The end title song for the Toni Morrison documentary was a real gift to be able to write and perform. I was thinking about her work and how impactful she had been for me as an artist. So I wrote that song, High Above the Water, and they ended up using it. The Emmy nomination for the Toni Morrison documentary was just fantastic honor. To be acknowledged by your peers was a real honor. The Amy Tan documentary and received an Emmy nomination for that score, again, that was really rewarding in the sense that it was a heavy piano score and was very effortless for me to create. To have that acknowledged and appreciated, hey, it was wonderful. I think it has been fascinating that I've been asked to score for people who are celebrated worldwide. Amy Tan, August Wilson, Toni Morrison, Rita Moreno, and so forth. I try to come from an honest place, from an authentic place. And I think all the people that I've named also came from an authentic place. I had received the invitation to join the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences back in 2016. Film scoring is storytelling in a very real sense. Do I consider myself a storyteller or a griot? Absolutely. I just always wanted to be, for me, about the work itself. Part of my journey as a storyteller has brought me incredible opportunity in the symphonic world. I think it's an incredible honor to be a part of the orchestral community and also to demystify what's possible for women and specifically for African-American women. What does the future hold for Kathryn Bostic? That's hard for me to really put into words, because I am still amazed at endless possibilities that keep coming my way. I will say I do want to begin to focus also on my singer-songwriting, but I'm pretty open. As long as I'm making music, I'm a happy girl. I'm a happy, happy person.